let's stand to our feet, and we're going to open up in a word of prayer. I know we got the high school girls still on their way over from their class. They'll be here momentarily. But let's go ahead and pray, and let's pray for a good chapel today. And then Brother Karinger will come up and lead us in our first song, and we'll get into some announcements and sword drills for the day. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. Thank you for all you do for us, Lord. I pray you give us a good day in your house and in church tonight and chapel here in the within this next hour. And, Lord, we look forward to hearing from you. And, Lord, I pray you be with our guest speaker today, Brother Briley. I pray you fill him with your Holy Spirit and just use him as a mouthpiece to speak to our hearts and give us what we need today, Lord. Convict us where we need it most and just give us what we need to hear. And we pray for the same for church tonight as Pastor will preach tonight. And, Lord, we pray for those that are sick, that are out, Brother Aiello and a few others, Lord. Pray just be with them. Allow them to get feeling better so they can return very soon. And, Lord, I pray just give us a good day today. Give us safety in everything we do. We love you. Help us bring honor and glory to your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Everybody stay standing. Grab your books. Go to number 23. 23 as we open up our chapel service for today. Isn't he wonderful? Sing it out. Girls, y'all got to have to sing extra loud because only half of you are here, okay? So sing it out loud. Here we go. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? So one more time, a little bit faster. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, it's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful?
All right, you may be seated. Let's go ahead and look at our announcements for today and throughout the week. And here in just a moment, we'll get into our sword drills. George will lead us in those. But anyways, let's look at our announcements for this week. Let's not forget Characters for Christ tonight at 6 o'clock and Proteins class or soul winning at 7 o'clock or 6 o'clock tonight. I don't know why I'm getting everything mixed up. Proteins and Characters for Christ tonight at 6 o'clock. Don't miss that if you're in 7th grade nut. We have soul winning tonight. And let's be there. Let's be in our place. And always bring a few dollars in case we make a quick stop somewhere before church. Normally we swing in through McDonald's if we have time or a gas station or something quick. But that'll be tonight at 6. And then those that are younger, 6th grade and below, you're encouraged to come to Characters for Christ. They meet in that building at 6 o'clock, and they do a lot of different stuff over there. A lot of fun. Don't miss that. And then also this Friday, there is a away volleyball game for the girls. They're playing at West Meadows, which will be held in Jacksonville. So make sure if you're able to go to that game, cheer on the girls in their game. If not, if you're not tied up with volleyball, there is a youth rally this Friday night at Lighthouse Baptist Church in Orlando. We will be leaving. I will give you all the details by tonight. I'll send out a text this afternoon, and I will have a sign-up sheet on the glass doors of the building, the classroom building over there. So if you're planning to go Friday, please make sure you sign up. There's no cost, free food, all that stuff. I will give you all the details later on today. And that's all the announcements I have for now. Let's not forget Harvest Sunday coming up on October 27th. It's going to be here before you know it. You don't want to miss that. It's going to be a big day here at Riverland, and we'll have a good day in church that day. What we're going to do is we're going to have hot dogs for everybody that comes and a couple other things. Younger kids, there's going to be bounce houses and all kinds of different stuff, and that'll all be lined up for us. That is 1 week from this Sunday, and also it's the starting date of our Spanish services, and Brother Karinger will be heading that up. Looking forward to that, and he's going to do a good job with that, and he's definitely be praying for the start of the Spanish ministry on October 27th. As that gets started, if you know anybody, maybe you have neighbors that are Spanish, maybe if you have know somebody in your neighborhood, anything like that, give them a flyer, and Brother Karinger has special flyers you can give to them that's written out in Spanish. Give them one of these. There's a Spanish section on the top right corner telling them that they're going to start services that day for Spanish-speaking people, and we look forward to all of that. So be a help and be a blessing in that way. All right, Brother George, come on up and lead us in some sword drills.
Okay, everybody. Man, there's no girls over here. All right, till the girls get here. Girls, scoot up. Come on, scoot up, everybody. Come on, come on, come on. So I can hear you. I can't hear you because you guys are young. All right, we're going to start this. We got hundreds instead of 50s because 50s are no fun. Who's got merit store pretty soon? I know we have it tomorrow, high school. When's the younger kids?
Mrs. Griffin.
Kindergarten's Friday. Mills next week. All right, so we got some bigger merits. And then Brother Keith's going to ask a big question for the 500. All right, so let's get started. Here we go. Everybody get your Bibles up by the spine. Come on. Hurry up, guys. Psalms. Oh, we got to skip that one. I said it. All right, here we go. Three. 320. Revelation. Cheating. Revelation 320. Go. Good job, James. Come get your merit. Hurry up, hurry up. Micah. This is for the young kids right here. Are you ready, guys? I give you everything right off the bat. Micah 3:8.
Micah
3:8.
Micah 3:8.
Go. Come on here, Dustin. I give you hints in the Old Testament. Not the new one. Not the end of the Bible. Micah 3:8. Good job, Madison. Here you go. All right, next one. Five. Philemon 5:5:5. Go. That's a trick question, guys. Because. No Philemon 5, but we better find it because it's definitely in there. There's definitely 5 in there. Philemon 5. I didn't say 5. That's not Philemon 5. Guys, there's only one chapter in Philemon, so find it. Philemon 5. Right there, Nathan. Someone who's got some brains in this offshore. Alright, next. 23. 19. 23:19. Pause. Come on, ladies, hurry up. We're doing sword drills. 23:19. I don't know how to say it, but we're gonna go for it. Nahum. 23:19. People say it different. Nahum. Nahum. Repeat it. Nahum. Or however you want to say it. Go. 23:19. Nahum. 23:19. And then we're gonna have a question for. Name them, Nahum, however you want.
There is no 23:19.
Well, hey, look, I got it right here.
George.
Okay, maybe not. Guys, I'm using a book. We're trying something new. We're doing a book. If it's. Forget it. We'll go to the next one.
There's a trick.
All right. We'll go to the next one. All right, kindergarten, raise your hand. Kindergarten, that's you here, Dustin. All right, I have a question for you. You ready? You guys have been learning about Jacob, right? Right? Everybody say yes. Learn about Jacob. Now, when he went to the farm, what was one of the wives that he married? What was one of the wives? Caleb, you remember? You don't remember any of the ladies? There's two of them. He married two of them. All right, I'll give you a hint. Starts with re. Re. Or the other lady starts with Lee. Leah, good job. Come here and get your merits. All right, back sword drills. Here we go. And the other lady's name was Rebecca. Rebecca and Leah. Good job. All right, 20. 31. 20. 20:31. John 20:31. Go. Aiden. All right, guys. He won. It's all right. Calm down. I made a mistake. It's not Nehemiah's numbers. My bad. Just minor mistakes, but that's okay. We're going to redo it. 23:19. Got it right this time. I had some counseling. I went to whatever you call those people who talk with you. I don't know. But 23:19, numbers. 23:19, go. Numbers, like not the numbers on the page. Isaiah? All right, Isaiah, cook your numerics. It helps to yell the loudest, guys. Oh, Ian? All right, come and get your mirror, dude. All right. Burke Herringer, can you ask the question? Guys, this is 500 numerics. It's going to be a hard question.
All right. Just going to start off with it really hard, and I might make it one step easier if someone cannot remember. All right, are you ready?
Yes.
This is not a sword drill. There were three times in the Bible that God wrote with his own hand, with his finger. What are the three times? You think you know all three? It wasn't, you got the right guy, but the wrong story. He wasn't in the lion's den during this time. You're close. Do you remember what happened? He was with the king. There was a party. Okay, so that's one. That's when God wrote on the wall. Oh, no. Good try, though. Good job for getting one of them. Does anybody else remember the other two? Shalante. Okay, he wrote on the ground. So now there's. So what's the other one that Layla just said? Right on the wrote on the wall. And what was the third time that God wrote? Huh? What'd you say? Rachel. Ten Commandments. That's right. That's right.
Okay, I'll say.
How about those three? Okay, those three. Is there a, we'll get all three of you some because you all three got one. So, Shalante, well, Rachel doesn't really need merits.
You just have the credit of saying you got it.
I'll take money.
Okay. All right, good job, guys. Good job.
It's all yours.
All right, good job, Layla, Rachel, and Shalante, and everybody else that got a sword drill. If you got a sword drill, raise your hand. Isaiah, James, Aiden, Ian, Mr. Dorsey, Maddie. Who else got one? Haley, did you get one? You got one? Good job. All right, Nathan, did you get one? Good job. All right, pretty good. All right, I'm going to go over the announcements just one more time because I know a lot of the girls were not in here. Just want to remind you. What's going on? Proteins tonight at 6 o'clock, visitation. We're going door-to-door, passing out Harvest Day Sunday flyers, and they have the gospel on the back. So be there tonight at 6 o'clock. Please be on time so we can leave on time, and that'll be tonight at 6. Characters for Christ, for those in 6th grade and below, me in the building across the way. Also, I will have a sign-up sheet up this afternoon on the glass door building of the classroom building over there for the youth rally on Friday going to Lighthouse Baptist in Orlando. I will give you details this afternoon in a text message, so make sure you're on the text list there, and I will send all that out. Youth rally this Friday night and volleyball game away at West Meadows at 5 o'clock. So girls will be praying y'all do well in your game. And I think that's all the announcements for now. And Harvest Sunday coming up 1 week from Sunday. Don't forget about that, and make sure you're passing those out if you can. We got plenty of those. All right, Brother Carringer, come on up. Lead us in another song.
Everybody stand up one more time. Grab your blue hymn book this time. Go to number 391. 391. We're going to sing I'd Rather Have Jesus, one of my favorite hymns in the hymn book. Jesus needs to be what we want than anything else. All right, 391, I'd Rather Have Jesus. Here we go. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hands than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. We're going to do the last verse. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out of the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
All right, you may be seated. All right, I'm very excited about our guest speaker today. I've gotten to know Brother Briley over the last, I don't even think it's been a year yet, since our youth rally back in April, May, whenever we held our rally. I can't remember. But last May we held our last rally, and Brother Briley's got some teens with him, Diego and Gabriel, with them today. And I'm glad they were able to join him. But many of y'all just went to Brother Briley's youth rally a couple weeks ago at Calvary Baptist in Fruitland Park. And how many of y'all were there? We went to that youth rally. I know we brought a load of y'all. And we had several bus teams that came with us as well that are not here. But anyways, it was very good, and we heard a good message from Brother Sams. Anyways, I'm excited about hearing from Brother Briley today, so let's sit up straight, let's open up our Bibles, and let's listen up with our ears and with our hearts. And Brother Briley, you come on up, and you preach for us this morning. Make a
well, good morning. How are y'all doing? Raise your hands again. How many of y'all went to that youth rally that we had at our church? Great, great. Thank y'all so much for coming. And I know it's sometimes discouraging when you invite a lot of people and only a few come. And sometimes you're planning on going to someone else's youth rally and a lot of kids sign up and only a few show up. And so thank y'all for showing up. I'm glad y'all came. Hope you enjoyed it. We had a lot of fun putting that on. Diego and Gabe were in the skit with my brother David, and they had a lot of fun putting that on as well. And so just thank y'all for being wonderful guests while we're having that. Well, let's open our Bibles, and we're going to go to Joshua chapter 1 this morning. Joshua chapter 1. So I grew up in a place called Costa Rica. How many of y'all know where Costa Rica is? Raise your hand. All right, where's Costa Rica? Anybody else know where Costa Rica? Not you guys. I know y'all know. Where's Costa Rica? South? It's south. Yes, it is south. Anybody know where exactly south it is? Anybody? No? Costa Rica is in between Panama and Nicaragua, and those are Latin American countries in Central America, and my folks are missionaries down there, and that's where I got to grow up, and so I'm excited about hearing that y'all are starting a Spanish ministry, and I've gotten to talk with Brother Keith a few times about what is going on here, and if any of y'all have friends or family, or maybe you are bilingual and speak Spanish, help out, because there's Spanish folks that are coming to Florida all the time, millions, literally millions, and they don't speak English, and they need someone to tell them about the love of Jesus. They need someone to show them the love of Jesus. They need someone to show them how they can go to heaven, and and they need someone to come alongside them and help them grow. And so you guys especially, since y'all are younger, many times the children of Spanish families are bilingual and they speak both languages. So take advantage of that and make friends with Spanish kids so that we can reach their parents. And God can use you in that way. And so I'm excited about that too. Well, if you don't mind, let's stand one more time. Joshua chapter 1. And we're going to just read the first 9 verses. And we're just going to talk about one word this morning, the word choose. Can we say that word together? Choose. One more time. Choose. Choose. Joshua chapter 1 and verses 1 through 9. What we'll do is I'll read the first verse, and then you guys read with me on the second. I'll read the third, and we'll read intermittently like that all the way down to verse 9. We'll read verse 9 together, okay? I'll start with verse 1. It says, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying," read with me, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. Be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written there. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success." Everybody on verse 9, "Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest." I pray, God, that you would bless this morning's message, as it has been a blessing to me and our teenagers, and I just pray that you would encourage these teenagers and these children this morning in choosing to serve you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You can sit down. Thank you for standing. You know, choices are something God has given to all of us, and there's a false teaching out there, guys, where they say that you don't have a choice whether you go to heaven or not, that God has already chosen that for you, and that you can't really pick where you're going to go, because God created you and decided, he stamped you destined for heaven or destined for hell. And how many of y'all understand that's a false teaching right there? Because the Bible says we all have the choice to believe or not believe on Jesus as your Savior. And before we do anything else, I just want to challenge you. If you have never truly believed on Jesus Christ as your Savior, that is the most important choice you will ever make in your life. More important than who you marry. More important than what you eat for breakfast. More important than what church you go to. More important than what job you find. More important than who you decide are going to be your friends and who are not going to be your friends. The most important choice you will ever make in your life is whether or not you believe and receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. I grew up in a Christian home. Like I said, my parents are missionaries in Costa Rica, but I did not accept Christ for years until I became a teenager. I grew up in kindergarten. How many of y'all are in kindergarten? I went to a Christian school in kindergarten, and I heard the gospel plenty of times. I went to first grade in a Christian school. I heard the gospel plenty of times. We started homeschooling for a while, and even the material that we read was Christian, and I heard the gospel again and again and again, but I never truly accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior until I became a teenager. And it was hard, because all of my friends thought I was already a Christian. All my friends thought that I was, you know, the most spiritual kid in the youth group. You know, I wore a suit and tie to church. I went to a teen soul winning. I went on Wednesday nights. I was there for everything, you know. I memorized. I was good at sword drills, you know. All of that, but I wasn't saved. You see, none of that matters if you die and step out into eternity and you never chose to personally accept Christ. Sometimes in order to follow Jesus, in order to get saved, you're going to be embarrassed by your friends. You're going to be made fun of. They're going to say, oh, we thought he was or she was a Christian, and she really wasn't. It may take some humbling on your part to trust Christ. But if that's what it takes, it's worth it. I went forward in an altar
a camp, and there was kids everywhere, and friends of mine that thought I was saved, and I was crying not out of, you know, I was so happy to get saved, but I was embarrassed. And as a 13-year-old kid, came forward crying, but I didn't care anymore. You know why? Because I knew I needed to be saved. And the most important decision you'll ever make is the decision to trust Christ as your Savior. Choices are a part of everyday life. Just today, you have made the choice to obey your parents and get out of bed and come to school. You made the choice to what you ate for breakfast. You made the choice of going to class and being there on time. You made the choice to either pay attention or not pay attention in class. Sometimes we make choices that aren't even, it's not like we have to pray about it and think about it. We just do it, right? So many times the way we feel has a lot to do with the choices that we make. I feel tired, so I'm not going to pay attention. I feel tired, so I'm not going to go to church today. Or I feel angry, so I'm going to lash out at this person who I'm angry at. We make choices many times based on emotions. Well, here in this passage, we see Joshua as a man who made very, very wise choices in his youth. How many of y'all are youth today? Raise your hand. Okay. All of us pretty much are youth in here. Even the adults are not too old. Okay. All of us can learn from these lessons this morning. So here in this situation, let me describe to you, Moses is dead. Moses is what? Dead. Okay, everybody go like this. He's dead. He's down under. All right, he's gone. Moses many times is hailed as like the greatest ever. Many Jews even worship him. They almost talk more about him and care more about Moses than they do about God himself. Moses was a big deal to the Israelites. He was their leader, okay? Imagine, guys, if your mom and dad all of a sudden died today. And no longer were they the ones that helped you do right. You had to do right for yourself. Many of the Jews, they followed Moses because Moses followed God. And so when Moses died, there was no leader now. And Joshua has to step up and challenge Israel to choose to serve God, to make the choice for themselves who they're going to serve. Because Moses is no longer there to help them get up and go to the tabernacle and worship God and confess their sin when they need to. He's no longer there to make sure they're not serving other gods and following after the gods of the other nations around there. Moses is dead. And one day, unfortunately, we're all going to die. Your pastor is going to die one day. If the Lord doesn't come back and we're all raptured first, your youth pastor is going to die. Brother Keith, you're going to die one day. I'm sorry. I'm going to die one day. And you know what? You're going to have the responsibility, probably even before we die, you're going to have to step up and decide you're going to serve God for yourself. Here in Joshua, at the very end of the book, Joshua challenges the people. He says, "Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth." Serve him for real. Not because you want to please somebody else, not because you want to keep up appearances, but serve God because you mean it from your heart. Serve God in sincerity and in truth. "And put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt." In other words, put away those gods which Israel went following after on the other side of the River Jordan. Put away those gods and serve you the Lord. And he says at the very end of this passage, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." See, Joshua had a decision that he had made long before that chapter and long before he actually said that. He had chosen way back in chapter 1 that he was going to serve God. And it didn't matter what everyone else did. It didn't matter what they thought. He was going to do what is right. Every young person must make his or her own decision to serve God. No one else can make that decision for you. No one else can make that choice for you. Other people can encourage you in that decision, but ultimately you will decide for yourself whether to serve God or not. Serving God isn't just about going into full-time Christian ministry, no. Serving God has to do with just walking with God, having a relationship with God. I was talking with Diego and Gabe on the way over here that the Christian life isn't about just full-time Christian ministry. It isn't about being a youth pastor, being a pastor, a pastor's wife, or a Christian school teacher. The Christian life is about your walk with God. It's about your personal relationship with God. And there's a lot of young people that attend church, but they have no real relationship with God. So serving God isn't just about doing things for God, but about being who he wants you to be. God is more interested in you than what he can do with you. So, do you do right because someone else tells you to do right? maybe your parents or godly authorities here at church, or do you serve God because you want to yourself? Have you made that choice? You know, sometimes you got to make that choice day after day after day. But maybe you haven't made that choice in a long time and you've drifted away from the Lord, and today you need to make that choice again that I am going to serve God. And when temptation comes, I'm going to kick the devil in the teeth and say, I am going to serve God. As for me and my house, myself, maybe you don't come from a Christian home and you have the privilege of going to a Christian school here. Maybe there's unsaved family members in your family. Make the choice that as for me, I'm going to serve God. That's the best decision you could make after getting saved, is the decision to follow God and walk with him. Now, how did Joshua decide to serve the Lord? Number one, he sought God personally in his youth. Let's turn over to Exodus chapter 33. Y'all are pretty good at finding passages fast. And so let's turn to Exodus chapter 33. Exodus chapter 33. Genesis, what's the next verse? Next book, not verse. Genesis, Exodus 33 and verse number 7. I want you to notice what it says about the tabernacle, what it was for, and where Joshua spent most of his time. Exodus 33 and verse 7. The Bible says, and Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp, afar off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation. So this is the place where people go to worship God. And it came to pass that everyone which sought the Lord went out under the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without the camp. And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend, and he turned again into the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. You see, Moses built this place called the tabernacle, and it was a place that was built specifically so people could go if they wanted to seek God. If they wanted to walk with God, if they wanted to talk with God, if they wanted to have some quality time with God, they went to the tabernacle. Where did they go? Now, Moses was here at the tabernacle, and Joshua was like his right-hand man. It was like the young man that Moses could use to do things that he wasn't able to do because he was in charge of the whole congregation. So Joshua was his helper. But even when Moses left to go back into the camp, he left the tabernacle. Guess who stayed behind spending time with God? Joshua. And he wasn't an adult. He wasn't an old man at that point. He was a young man. He was one of you guys. And when everyone else was gone, he stayed behind because his spiritual life, his walk with God was important. Isaiah 55:6 says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, and he will abundantly pardon. Maybe you know that there's something holding you back, or maybe there's something that consistently trips you up in your walk with God. You know, that's not uncommon. Bible says there hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. It's not uncommon to be tempted. It's not uncommon to have stumbling blocks in your Christian life. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will provide a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. In other words, there's nothing that you can go through that God hasn't given you the grace and help to overcome so you can walk with him. God loves you. He wants to walk with you, but you've got to make the decision to walk with him. Joshua made that choice. He chose to seek God in his youth. He walked with God. I was telling Diego and Gabe on the way over here, talking about the will of God. Basically, do whatever you want as long as you're walking with God. Because when you are serving God, God will take care of everything else. You know what he told Abraham in Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 and 2? God only told Abraham two things. And by the way, Abraham was a great. He's the father of the faith. I mean, he's a huge example of faith and how he decided to give his own son, Isaac, to be sacrificed. Even though it was his only son, he trusted God and he obeyed God, knowing that God knew what he was doing. That's a big thing. How many of y'all would go and sacrifice your own brother? Well, probably y'all would be happy to do that, but some of y'all. But how many of you would be willing to do something like that because you knew God knew what he was doing? But Abraham stepped out and he obeyed, and Abraham had that reputation that he obeyed right away. He left his hometown, even not knowing where he was going, simply because God had told him to do it. That's faith. Abraham knew that he needed to walk with God, and in Genesis 17, 1 and 2, we don't have to turn there, but God tells Abraham only two things. He commands him, walk before me and be thou perfect. In other words, he didn't say, Abraham, I want you to go to Bible college, and I want you to get a degree, and then I want you to go start a church in Philadelphia. You know, he didn't give him any specifics. He said, it doesn't matter what you do, Abraham. What matters is who you are, and I want you to be my friend. I want you to walk before me and be perfect. See, God's interested in your heart. He's interested in you, but you have to make the choice that you're going to walk with him. You have to make the choice. So number one, Joshua sought God in his youth. Number two, he knew and lived God's word. Some of y'all answered the question about where the three times where God wrote in the Bible, and I only thought of the one where he wrote on the wall, but I hadn't thought about the other two. That's a pretty cool question. I might use that with the youth group. But y'all knew God's word, and you know, among you, you were able to figure it all out. Many of y'all have, I'm sure, scripture memorized. We have a competition in our youth group where we're memorizing Psalm chapter 1, and the winners get a prize for that. But you know and obey and live God's word, and that's a choice that you have to make. There's incentives, you know, that we do here at Christian school and at church and in the youth group for you to get motivated to do it. But what about when there's no motivation? What about when your only motivation is, I know this is right. I know I need to memorize God's word. I know I struggle in this area of anger, so I'm going to memorize scripture on that topic. I know I struggle with lust, so I'm going to memorize scripture that has to do with that issue. I know I struggle with faith and unbelief, so I'm going to memorize and meditate on that kind of scripture. Where's the motivation coming from? Because Joshua had a motivation to know and live God's word himself. Look at verse 7 of Joshua chapter 1. Go back to Joshua chapter 1 and look at verse 7. Joshua chapter 1, verse 7. Joshua says, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success. You know, it's interesting that you don't have prosperity or success until the word of God becomes important in your Christian life. You want to see prosperity and success in the Christian life, in God's eyes? Then obey God's word. Meditate on it day and night. Hide it in your heart. You know, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, the Bible says, get wisdom. Proverbs 1:1 says, my son, if thou wilt receive my words, talking about the Bible, and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding. God is saying, basically, if you will hunger after the Bible the way you hunger after food, and you will desire of your own self, out of your own heart, he says, apply thine heart to it. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and the knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom. Out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. James chapter 1 says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and abradeth not, but let him ask in faith. In other words, God is the source of wisdom. And as you are young people, now is the time to maximize your wisdom, okay? You need to all be wise men and wise women. Wisdom isn't very popular with the world. Wisdom is like, it's almost like it's an untouchable fantasy thing. Wisdom isn't even a normal word in the world. But it's a normal word with God. And God desires that we in our youth seek wisdom, seek God's word, seek God's truth in his word. And if we will look for it as if we were looking for a hidden treasure, the Bible says, then we'll understand the fear of the Lord. Then you'll begin to understand the knowledge of God. You know, King David was in love with the Bible. In Psalm 119:97, he said, oh, how love I thy law. It is my meditation all the day. King David meditated on God's word. He wrote much of God's word. When he was out keeping the sheep, you know, you think it was God's will that he kept the sheep? I don't know. Maybe God didn't even care. But what God's will was for his life was that he walk with God. I know that for sure. God's will for David's life as he was keeping the sheep was to meditate on his word. And David did that. You know, I don't think it really mattered to the Lord whether he was keeping sheep or whether he was working in the house or whether he was a cook or what he was. But what mattered to God was that he walked with God. He sought God. He knew God's word and he loved God's word. Number three is this: Joshua obeyed the godly authority in his life. Ouch. Sometimes we don't like that one. Because you know what? Godly authorities, if it's not God himself, godly authorities still make mistakes. So many times I've had to apologize because I planned an activity and it didn't work out. And sorry, guys, fail. My part. Will you forgive me? Why? Because I'm human. You know, Brother Pitts is human. Brother Keith is human. Your teachers are human. You're human. We make mistakes. And even though we are considered the godly authority in your life, we make mistakes too. You know who doesn't make a mistake, though? God. The Lord won't make mistakes. But if you will take the godly authority in your life and you will obey them, always understanding that God is the ultimate authority, and so obviously whether you should obey God or man, who is the one you should obey? God, absolutely. So when your godly authority conflicts with God's word, obviously follow God's word, but 99% of the time your godly authority is leading you in the right direction. Joshua 11, verse 15 says, "As the Lord commanded Moses, his servant, so did Moses command Joshua, and so did Joshua. He left nothing undone that all the Lord commanded Moses." So Moses was Joshua's godly authority. I wonder if Joshua would have ever even been in the tabernacle if Moses hadn't led him there. But he had a godly authority that he submitted himself to willingly and with a happy heart. And because of that, God blessed him. He obeyed the godly authority in his life. Exodus 20, verse 12 says, "Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee." How many of you want to live a long life? Raise your hand. My hand's up. How many of you don't want to live a long life? Raise your hand. Yeah. Probably not everybody wants to live a short life. We want to live a long life, and the Bible literally says that you can lengthen or shorten your days by your obedience to your godly authority. Honor thy father and thy mother. Hebrews 13:17 says, "Obey them that have the rule over you, and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable you." We're talking about choices. You have to make a choice whether you're going to honor your father and your mother, whether you're going to submit yourself happily with a good heart to your godly authority here at church. You have to make a choice whether you're, you know, sometimes you don't know whether you should, what you should do in your life. There's a big decision. But your godly authority has some wisdom to give you that will help you help guide you in the right direction. Submit yourself to that godly authority as Joshua submitted himself to Moses. So number one, he sought God in his youth. Number two, he learned and lived God's word. And number three, he submitted himself, obeyed his godly authority. So in conclusion, what happens? God selects Joshua as the next leader of Israel. Now, did Joshua go and tell Moses, "Moses, will you put my name in the hat? Will you consider me to be the next leader of Israel?" No, Joshua never did that. Okay. Whoever the next pastor is here, I doubt it's going to be the person who goes up and says, "Can I be the next pastor? Let me be the next pastor." Because the person who wants the job that bad isn't the person who gets the job, but the person who gets God's jobs are the ones who are seeking him, the ones who know and live his word, and those who submit themselves willingly to their godly authorities. Those are the people that God can say, "I can use that young lady. I can use that young man." And by the way, God can use you now. Don't wait until later and think, "Oh, God using me is going to be me going out into the mission field or some big thing like that." God can use you in big ways now. That's why teen soul winning and being a witness to your friends is so important, because probably the best reward you will ever get here on this earth is the reward of getting to lead someone else to Christ. But God's going to pick the people who are walking with him, the people who choose to learn and live by his word, and those who choose to submit themselves to their godly authorities. So what are your choices this morning? Have you ever made the first choice to accept Christ? In Numbers chapter 27, verse 16, it says, "Let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, set a man over the congregation." This is where God is picking Joshua. "Which may go out before them, and which may come in before them, and which may lead them out, and which may bring them in, that the congregation of the Lord be not as sheep which have no shepherd." Where do we go to find a good shepherd for God's people? I'll tell you where they went. Verse 18, and the Lord said unto Moses, take thee Joshua, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay thine hand upon him. God chose Joshua. But long before God chose Joshua, Joshua was choosing God day by day in his regular life, personally. Did you choose God this morning? Maybe you say, Pastor Brother John, I don't spend time with God in the morning. I do it at night. That's great. Do you spend time with God every day, though? I'll tell you, I'll be honest with you, in my teenage life, that's the biggest thing I struggled with, and it's the biggest thing that crippled me in my adult life. Because in my younger life, I had an inconsistent walk with God. Your walk with God is what will give you the stability in your Christian life. It's what will give you a foundation to be able to live, and it's what will help you grow. It's hard to build a building on top of a foundation that's not stable. Just whatever little wind will come and the building will fall, and that's how your Christian life is if your walk with God isn't consistent. You know, if you need some help with getting consistency in your walk with God, talk to a godly leader, someone who you know already walks with God faithfully, and say, hey, how can I do better in this area? How can I walk with God consistently and not be distracted, not be lazy about it, but be real and sincere about my walk with God? Because that's what's going to set the course for your Christian life. Everyone wants God to use them for something special. Everybody does. Everybody wants to do something great for God. That's awesome. That's great. But not everyone makes the choice, the correct choice of who to serve. God will choose you, but you got to choose him first. I'll finish with the illustration of a man named Phineas. Anybody ever heard of the name Phineas? I'm not talking about Phineas and Ferb. I'm talking about a man in the Bible, a man named Phineas. Phineas was basically, he wasn't a nobody, to be honest, but the job he had was kind of a dumb job. He was a doorkeeper. Okay, that was his job. You ever seen the people with the fancy clothing that stand in front of hotels and all their job is to open the door and close the door? Okay, that was Phineas, all right? He wasn't a Joshua. He wasn't a Moses. All Phineas did was he lived in the tabernacle, and his job was to open the doors in the morning and close the doors at night. His job also included making sure that nobody that wasn't clean came into the tabernacle and made sure that the place was clean. But Phineas had something in his heart that God saw was special. You see, one day the congregation of Israel was gathered together, and they were praying, and they were actually confessing sin because there were some people in Israel who had gone and joined themselves to the ungodly women of Midian. Okay, they were wicked people. They served false gods. They lived wickedly. And the young men went and they were marrying and taking these girls and living with them. And there was just a mess, a spiritual mess in Israel. And as the congregation is there weeping together, the Bible says, Moses is there, Joshua is there, the keepers of the doors are there, Phineas is there. There's a man who brings a Midianitish woman right in front of everybody with no shame and takes them right in front of everybody to his house. And everyone's shocked. What is going on here? I mean, the gall of this guy to do something so ungodly in front of everyone. And Phineas said, I can't stand it. And the Bible says he stood up, he took a javelin, and he speared them both through and killed them. And the Bible says that God made a covenant with Phineas because he had done right in God's eyes. You see, in Israel law, the certain wickednesses, certain sins had the death penalty. And Israel had not been killing the people they were supposed to be killing. And Phineas stood up and said, I'm not gonna let this go on. He stood up, took a javelin in his hand, and speared them both through. And the Bible says that the zealousness in his heart, his zeal for God, gained him favor with God because he had a zeal for God. And he was a nobody. All he was a doorkeeper. But that doorkeeper had a zeal for God. There was something inside that God saw. Years later, when the Israelites came to the Jordan River, some of the tribes of Israel wanted to stay behind and on one side of the Jordan River, while the rest of them went on to the other side of Jordan River to conquer all the land and defeat everybody and split up the land. So three of the tribes, two and a half of the tribes, stayed behind on one side of the Jordan River, and they built an altar. Now that was dangerous because the Israelites were only supposed to have one God, and one God meant one altar. How many altars? One altar. So when word got back to Joshua and the rest of the Israelites that their family members on the other side of the Jordan River had built another altar, well, they were worried. They thought, man, they must be serving a different God. So they said, we got to find somebody who's zealous for God, somebody who is spiritual, to go and deal with this situation. Who can we find? And guess whose name came up? Phinehas. I wonder why Phinehas' name came up. Phinehas was chosen for this important mission to go back across the Jordan River and figure out what was going on and thank the Lord. By the way, they weren't serving a false god. It turns out they were building an altar on their close to where they live so they could serve God in case their brothers and sisters on the other side of the Jordan River started serving a false god. They could still serve God at their altar. So their intentions were pure. It turns out they didn't have to, you know, deal with any sin there. But who did they pick to go and deal with the sin? Someone who had dealt correctly with sin in the past. Phinehas. And teenagers and young people, children, God will pick you and use you for bigger things as you make consistent choices to serve God and seek God, to live and learn, obey His word, and to submit yourself to your godly authority. Let's have every head bowed and every eye closed. Heads bowed and eyes closed. I don't know how y'all normally do invitation, but here's the way we're going to do it this morning. With their heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm just going to ask two questions mainly. Number one is, are you saved? Because that's the first choice you've got to make. None of the other choices really matter if you're not saved, if you're not a child of God. You may be like I was, sitting under the preaching all the time. Maybe you're trusting an obscure, faint decision when you were young that you don't even remember that clear. That's what happened to me. My sister said, pray this prayer, you're going to hell, so I prayed it. And I was trusting that for a long time, whether I was going to heaven. But the truth is, I never made a personal choice to accept Christ as my Savior. And maybe that's the choice you need to make this morning. So with your heads bowed and eyes closed, how many say, Pastor John, the truth is, I've got doubts about it. I've got doubts about where I'd go if I died today. I got doubts about maybe a decision I made in the past, or I've never made a decision to trust Christ. But pray for me, Pastor John, because I have doubts. Is there anybody like that this morning? No one's looking around, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Only the teachers and pastors are looking because we love you. How many say, Pastor John, pray for me because I have doubts in my heart about that? There's no shame, but let's be real with God today. Can we be real? Can we be authentic? Doesn't matter what the person next to you thinks. Doesn't matter what the boy or girl that likes you thinks. What matters is what God thinks. Let me say, Pastor John, pray for me because I have doubts. Anybody like that at all? All right, the second question is this. What are your choices? Have you made the choice to serve God, whatever He would have you to do in the future? Have you made the choice to obey and seek God day by day today? Have you made the choice to learn and live, obey His word? Have you made the choice to submit willingly and happily to your godly authorities? Do your choices reflect that you love God or that you love yourself? How do you say, Pastor John, pray for me? Either I've made some choices that I need to correct, or I want to continue to make choices that are godly. How many say, pray for me like that, Pastor John? Pray for my choices that they would honor God. Anybody got their hand raised? Anybody like that? Amen. Praise the Lord. Brother Pitts, if we could take a few minutes, and if your heads are bowed and eyes are closed, if you'd like to come and pray at the altar, you can. We're just going to take some time right now. If you'd like to come and do business with God, you come and do it. And then, Brother Pitts, you can take over.
Joshua's example this morning. Are you seeking God with your life right now in your youth? Do you know God's word? Are you living it? Are you obeying your godly authorities that God has placed in your life? Your parents, your youth pastor, your pastor? Are you listening to the advice they're giving you? Your teachers? God's placed them there for a reason. Thank you. decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Every head bow, every eye closed. Just want to ask you something real quick this morning. As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, are you following Joshua's example? You know, Joshua, not only did he seek God in his youth, but not only did he know God's word and he lived it, but not only did he obey his authorities, but there are so many blessings that came to follow because of the seeds that he sown when he was a teenager, when he was a young person. And boy, did he reap those rewards for a long time to come. And young person, if you would just sow your seeds of righteousness today, you're going to be glad you did it when you're an adult. You're going to look back one day and you're going to think, I'm glad I walked with God then. Because the day is coming, you're going to need him. The day of heartaches is on his way. The day of loss is on its way. The day of losing something or someone is on its way. The hard times in life, they're on their way, and before they get here, I hope you know God before they get here. Because trust me, when the storm comes, it's much better to be hand in hand with God than it is to be by yourself. And Joshua was prepared for the big days, but there are blessings that came with those big days as well. There were so many things that trials that Joshua went through that turned into his testimony. And he was able to look back and think, you know what? God got me through that. It's so important you have a relationship with God today, so that way you'll be ready for tomorrow. How's your relationship with God today? How is it? Do you have one? Is it there? Is it real? Is it consistent? We heard a Class A message this morning. Really, we did. And that was a fantastic message. Let's pray, and we'll talk about it in just a moment. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day. I pray, Lord, you help each and every young person in this room, from the youngest all the way to the oldest. Lord, help us all to have a consistent walk with you. Help us, Lord, to draw close to you, and may you draw nigh to us as well. And, Lord, I pray that we would prepare for the future by preparing today and having that relationship with you that we need to have. Lord, I pray you bless each and every young person in this room. Help them, Lord, to know that there's blessings on the way that come with every act of righteousness that we do. Lord, help us to do what is right. Help us to start today. May we do it on a daily basis. Lord, we love you. We thank you for all you do for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. That was a good message this morning. And Brother Briley, thank you very much for coming over and preaching for us. That was fantastic. And what we're going to do here in just a moment, we already prayed. But Brother Briley, if you'd like to wait by the door, and anybody that would like to get their Bible signed on the way out, they can do that. Now, we're kind of right on time to go to lunch, so if you'd like to get your Bible signed, please do that quickly and with Brother Briley, and make sure you don't wait around for to ask him. Please go ahead and do that immediately, all right? We already prayed. We already got the announcements made, so you guys are dismissed.